Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
The new book, Tears, We Cannot Stop, A Sermon to White America, has been described as a searing conversation on race. I'm Michael Real, and this is RealUrbanNews.com. We are one-on-one with New York Times best-selling author and social critic, Michael Eric Dyson.
Today we saw the 45th president of the United States be sworn in. Are we doomed because of Donald Trump?
Well, I wouldn't say we're doomed. We're certainly challenged. The great mystic Howard Thurman said, never reduce your life to the event that you confront now. You are not what you confront. He said that our slave foreparents, for instance, faced enormous odds, extraordinary opposition, but they imagined a different future. My pastor used to say, we've already come through what we've come to. So we've been here before, like David against Goliath. The reason he could beat that giant is because he had beat and conquered lions and bears. So Donald Trump is not the worst we've seen. We have lived through segregation, post-Reconstruction, the era of lynching. We've lived through the Jim Crow terror of the Knight Riders and white supremacy. We lived through white and black water fountains and schools and separation and segregation. So Donald Trump certainly betokens and gestures toward a return to a very problematic and flawed past, but we've got to fight him tooth and nail. We've got many more resources than we had even when we confronted those issues. We've got social media, we've got the ability of people to organize, the marches that are going on in the wake of his ascent. Sure. So I think we have options and alternatives rather than capitulation and despair.
What's motivating him?
Well, look, what motivates any person who wants to be president? All of them have huge egos. But Donald Trump, I think, is also motivated by the desire to see America return to a day and age that he nostalgically, if you will, remembers. And that's a day that was bad for a lot of people. It was bad for women. It was bad for African-American people. It was bad for Latinos and Latinas. It's a day in America where whiteness was unchallenged, where the dominant white culture didn't have to concede to the wishes of others. How do we know this? He constantly talks about being politically incorrect. I often find that that is a code word for a certain group of white powerful people to want to be able to do what they used to do, to spread bigotry, to excoriate others without being held accountable. And so I think Donald Trump's nostalgia for an America that only existed in his mind, or that existed in a time where people of color and women and others were seen as less than full citizens, is something that we have to really not only be conscious of, but I think are resistant to. Mm-hmm.
Staying politically focused, are we tired, Black America, of the Clintons?
Well, we ain't so tired that we prefer Donald Trump. And if we were tired, we were silly to be tired. You know, some people said, well, Hillary Clinton, she's not exciting. She's not your girlfriend. She's not your, quote, you know, partner. She's a president. We're not trying to elect a messiah. There were people who said, oh, it's maybe the choice of a lesser of two evils, but they're both bad equally. Are you serious? I mean, the kind of extraordinary and I think vicious false equivalencies that were put forward should be something we ought to think about. And I think the Clintons, had Hillary Clinton become president, that would have been an extraordinary thing. The first female president, an extremely intelligent and bright woman, charismatic in her own way, but a woman who understood policy, who understands in a policy wonkish kind of way the things that are necessary to get this country going. Here is a man that we've just elected who hasn't held the office of dog catcher.
Sure.
He's never held an elective office. we have now selected inexperience and, quite frankly, mediocrity as the predicate of national office holding. Because not only him, but many other people that he put into his administration and cabinet are equally incapable or incompetent and don't have the requisite experience in the jobs for which they have been nominated. So we're in tough times.
Your book, Tears, We Cannot Stop, A Sermon to White America, drops in history right when history is just bubbling over.
Yes, sir.
Perfect timing.
Well, thank you, Jesus. Some things you can't plan, right? And I was writing that book long before it became apparent that Donald Trump could actually become president. I mean, that was always the possibility because he was leading in the polls, in the primaries. But many people didn't believe he could actually become president, and Hillary Clinton was, you know, safely ahead. But I was writing this book in the aftermath of the Sterling and Castile murders, or killings by the police. I was outraged and upset and exhausted and fatigued, just tired of seeing death after death occur in our black and brown communities. And so I wanted to write about it. I wrote an op-ed that got an enormous response, and this book grew out of that. And I wanted to deal with whiteness because I wanted to say, this is what it came from. This is how Donald Trump emerged. These are the principles and practices that he amplifies that already existed before him, but certainly help explain the logic of his personality, the logic of his outlook, the logic of his perspective, and what he's trying to do in America today.
Poor white people voted for him.
Mm-hmm.
What's their attraction? Just the whiteness?
Well, it's the rhetoric as well. Okay. The ostensible commitment to working class people. Now, he's a billionaire, blue class billionaire. I mean, that's a contradiction in terms. Some would say an oxymoronic statement. But they feel that here's a guy who understands them, ironically enough. Now, this is a guy who doesn't pay his taxes. You poor white people do. You working class white people do. Here's a guy who's comfy with the Russians. Most of them are not. Here's a man who makes enormous sums of money, is not held accountable for them, and refuses to reveal the source of his money so that we can determine in a kind of explicitly transparent fashion whether or not you're being manipulated by people who, because they have something on you, could be nudging you to make certain decisions. We don't know because he won't reveal. So I think that the white working class thinks that they have a friend in Donald Trump and not a friend in Barack Obama, ironically enough. And yet Barack Obama's policies are far more friendly, or were far more friendly to the white working class than Donald Trump. So there is an allure and an appeal to the kind of white innocence that he represents, and the white privilege that he represents, and the desire to restore America to a time when bigotry, racism, and xenophobia were the order of the day.
Barack Obama describes you simply by saying everybody who speaks after Michael Eric Dyson pales in comparison. You're writing a grave for him. What would you give him for his 8 years as president?
Oh, wow, after you quote his nice thing he said about me, what do I give Obama? Look, as an American president who put this nation back on an even keel when it comes to economics, who rescued this economy, who bailed out the automobile industry and gave us the most historic and landmark piece of legislation since Social Security and the safety net, then Obama would have to get an A+. I mean, just what he did with enormous opposition. Now, when it comes specifically to race, maybe a C-. He didn't address the issues of race in a forthcoming fashion. And I didn't expect him to be a black nationalist, to go to his pulpit in the White House. That's a scandalous stereotype. You can be quiet. I don't want the commercial, I just want the product.
Sure.
And when we think about the issues that he could have addressed, skyrocketing unemployment, the mismatch, well, the disparity in powder cocaine and sentencing and crack cocaine, although they reduced it down to, I think, 18-1, they being the Justice Department, especially under Eric Holder.
Sure.
When you think about many of the other social issues that black people confront, they could have used a kind of bully pulpit, especially when we think about police brutality. Now, Obama spoke out tentatively, and then even he was excoriated by police unions who said he was just so pro black people and versus police departments, and many black people going, really, what president was that? So there were things that he certainly missed. The economic inequality of Black America rapidly proliferated under this president. So we can't pretend that we were better off in terms of
So Blacks are worse now.
Well, I think in terms of some of the indexes, they're not worse in terms of having somebody who at least wasn't viciously attacking them, and having a fellow African, an African American in there who's trying to work out, if you will, the country's problems and also pay attention to Black people. So, especially with the rise of Donald Trump, we can appreciate Mr. Obama, President Obama, even more. But we have to hold him to a standard that he wanted to hold us to. He went around the country saying that Black people should, you know, be held accountable and be responsible. Well, we flipped that right back to you. As the President of the United States of America, when Obama made the statement, "I am not the President of Black America." But you are the President of Black Americans. We are citizens after all. And basically what that leaves us with, as to draw a conclusion of, is that maybe a white person who's conscientious, like a Hillary Clinton, would have done more for Black people. Obama gave us the symbolic access and purchase, but he didn't give us the substantive economic and social, if you will, contributions that might have helped us in a significant fashion.
And then you hear Donald Trump posing the question, what do you have to lose to Black America?
Yeah, everything, the Blacks. The Blacks have everything to lose. Especially under the, if you will, new sense of attack and assault on Blackness that Donald Trump has helped to usher in. We are concerned because he has amplified some of the worst bigotries and inclinations in the American soul in the last half century. If Lincoln appealed to the better angels of our nature, Donald Trump, it seems to me, appeals to the worst demons of our consciousness.
As we prepare to close, looking at media and the landscape for African Americans, what's our responsibility in terms of telling our story? We've been inundated with reality television and we don't always look the best.
Right, right. Yeah, well, we have a responsibility to use what we have to open up minds, to challenge stereotypes, to reshape perceptions, and to provide the best glimpse and lens onto the excellence that motivates us, that often characterizes us. Look, people should be able to have fun. I think every genre of television or entertainment should exist. The problem with reality television is not that it's reality television. The problem with reality television is that it's dominant.
Now, we can do it right now. Let's do it now. Let's do it. Come on, man. Let's do it.
That becomes the major lens onto a landscape of African American and other minority identities. So when you think about it that way, if all that dominant white culture had was Keeping Up with the Kardashians,
sure,
or the Real Housewives of Orange County, or Miley Cyrus, no disrespect to Miley, twerk, twerk, Miley, that would be damaging, right? There are so many more alternatives. The problem with many minority people is that there are squeezed, limited, narrow alternatives, and we don't have a number of outlets to be able to express the beauty and the power and the diversity of who we are as a people.
You had a diverse crowd tonight out here in Pasadena, California for your book signing. How exciting was that opportunity to be in this melting pot in Southern California?
It was beautiful, man, even though, you know, the lies that were told about Southern California were manifest by Tony, Tony, Tony.
It never rains in Southern California.
It never rains. It never rains. No, it doesn't rain, dog. It just rains cats and dogs.
Sure.
I got to get Rafael Sadiq. I love you, bruh, but you misled me, man, because I believe you. You were reporting as a kind of sonic journalist to me. No, I mean, obviously, it's a beautiful prospect to be here in Southern California, where you have jarring juxtapositions between pockets of enormous conservatism and the beautiful progressive ideas that have animated this this particular region in pockets for a long time.
Finally, what's your hope for America?
That Donald Trump only served 4 years. That's I don't want to do to him what Mitch McConnell said he wanted to do to Barack Obama, make him a one-term president. I hope and pray that Donald Trump does not dismantle so much of the infrastructure that Barack Obama put in place. And certainly, on the first day in office, he's already given an executive order that challenges Obamacare in every major governmental, if you will, shop. Mm-hmm. I think that's a sad day for America. It's going to be more difficult to actually dismantle Obamacare. I think he will discover that, he being the new president. But my hope is that he's better than we fear he is, and that he's more sanguine, he's more balanced, he's more willing to listen to the other, and that he is not the bellicose belligerent bully that he has often portrayed himself to be.
Michael Eric Dyson, Tears We Cannot Stop, a sermon to white America. Thank you for being kind and generous.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
All right, sir.
Thank you, sincerely.
Thank you, my brother.